This is Biology 2160 for the lab, and today we're going to do a walkthrough of the muscular arm. So I want to start up here at the shoulder. The muscle that caps the shoulder is called the deltoid. This is a triangular shaped muscle. It has three large bands, an anterior, a middle, and a posterior band of fibers. And in terms of actions, this helps to adduct the arm. So this is going to be important in raising the arm, as in jumping jacks. So raising the arm. This also has a clinical aspect for our class. Coming about 3 inches down from the top of the shoulder, this would be an injection site. So we would inject vaccines here, for example, the COVID vaccine and the flu vaccination. Both of those are intramuscular vaccinations, and we could use this muscle here for that purpose. Out here, this is the pectoralis major muscle. And moving further down into the brachium, we have the biceps brachii. Bi means two. This has got two heads to it. We're going to have a long head and we're going to have a short head. The short head has an attachment site at the coronoid process of the scapula. The long head has its attachment on the glenoid cavity, but not before the tendon crosses through the intertubercular groove of the head of the humerus. So both of these heads converge on one tendon down here at the bottom and make its connection on the radius. This is not the prime mover of elbow flexion. Rather, the brachialis is the prime mover of elbow flexion. This muscle has a direct or fleshy attachment to the humerus, and it connects to the ulna. This one is the prime mover of elbow flexion. So in this compartment up here, these muscles are involved in flexion. If we move to the posterior side, we're going to see the triceps muscle. Triceps means that it has three heads. This is on the posterior side, and so this compartment comprises this muscle, and these are extensors. The heads are extensors. I also want to look at the muscles of the rotator cuff. These are the muscles that are going to surround the scapula and hold the head of the humerus into the glenoid cavity. So if we look here, we see our bony landmark. This is the spine of the scapula. And so above that, you of the supraspinatus muscle. Below the spine, we see the infraspinatus. And even further below that, we see the teres minor. So all three of those are holding the head of the humerus into the glenoid cavity. If we turn and rotate our arm so that we have the anterior view of the scapula, this muscle fills in the fossa, and this is called the subscapularis. Now you probably noticed a muscle just down below the sits group or the rotator cuff group. This is called the teres major. This is not one of the sits muscle. Instead, it has its connection on the border of the scapula and it has an attachment at the humerus. So it doesn't hold the head of the humerus into that glenoid cavity. Now let's look at the antibrachial region. In this region, we're going to focus on two compartments. the anterior compartment and the posterior compartment. The anterior compartment is comprised of a lot of muscles that are going to function in flexion of the wrist or flexion of the elbow. So in order to get oriented, we need to get a landmark here first. The first muscle we're going to look at is the palmaris longus. This muscle has a really long tendon. The tendon leads to an aponeurosis, a connective tissue that covers the palm of the hand. This is a good landmark because the tendon of this muscle goes over top of the flexor retinaculum, which is a connective tissue bracelet around the wrist. So once we have our landmark, then we can move to either side of this muscle and begin naming other muscles. This is the flexor carpi ulnaris. It flexes the wrist on the side of the ulna. This muscle is the flexor carpi radialis. It flexes the wrist at the side of the radius. This is the pronator teres. This functions in pronation. This muscle is the brachioradialis. It goes from the region of the brachium and down over the radius to the thumb. This muscle is involved in flexion of the elbow. There are a couple of deeper muscles. One of those we can see by looking at the muscle that is in between these tendons. This is called the flexor digitorum superficialis. So this muscle allows for flexion of the fingers. This is the rest of it. The other deep muscle in this compartment is the supinator. After you have pronated the arm, the supinator brings it back into anatomical position. Now let's look at the posterior side of the antibrachium. Again, like the anterior, it's easiest to identify muscles when we have a landmark to start with. This is the extensor digitorum. It has tendons that go out to the digits, so extending the fingers. Adjacent to that is the extensor carpi radialis longus. So this extends the wrist on the side of the radius, and this is a long muscle. Adjacent to it is the extensor carpi radialis brevis. Brevis means short. So this muscle also functions in extending the wrist on the side of the radius. One more muscle, and that's the extensor carpi ulnaris. This runs down to the little finger. So this extends the wrist on the side of the ulna. On our lab guide, I give you a few muscles that are of the hand. And so we've got several groups of muscles. Muscles that are associated with the small finger are a group called the hypothenar eminence. Muscles that are associated with the palmar region are called the mid-palmar group. And then finally, we have muscles that are associated with the thumb. These are the thenar eminence muscles. And so I wanted to go ahead and just name a few of these muscles, and I give them to you laterally to medially. The opponens, opponens pollicis. The adductor pollicis. The flexor pollicis brevis. And here at the fleshy crease between the thumb and the first finger is the adductor pollicis. Each of these, and it's not an all-inclusive list, are involved in movements of the thumb. This is the chest plate from one of our torso trunk models. On this model, I want to look at the abdominal muscles, a couple of the thoracic muscles, and a couple of the chest muscles. We're going to start with the abdominal muscles. This is the more superficial side. This is the deeper side. This cloudy appearance represents the rectus sheath, which is a very thin connective tissue layer over top of the rectus abdominis. The rectus abdominis is popularly known for its six-pack appearance when worked out efficiently and when eating appropriately allows for that to happen. The muscles are segmented, and that is due to the connective tissues that separate them, even though it is all one muscle. Down the middle, you have connective tissue line called the linea alba. It is intersected by tendinous intersections. Out to either side, you have an aponeurosis. This is the aponeurosis for the external abdominal oblique muscle. On the opposite side, you have the internal abdominal oblique muscle. In terms of the function, the rectus abdominis has parallel fibers, and these are straight downward. So this muscle is involved in flexion of the spine, as in doing a sit-up. Synergist to this movement are the external and internal abdominal obliques when they work in bilateral flexion. The external abdominal oblique is involved in lateral flexion on the opposite side of the body. So if this muscle is contracting right here, we would expect this side to bend over. The opposite is true for the internal abdominal oblique. When this muscle contracts, it is working on the same side, or ipsilaterally. So if this muscle contracts, this is the side that gets pulled down laterally. There is one more abdominal muscle, but we need to go deeper. So flipping this model over, we can see the transverse abdominis muscle in here. This muscle primarily just holds the contents of the abdomen in place. All of these muscles and the different arrangements of their fibers provide protection and support for the viscera, since there are no bones that surround them at the front part of the body. Now let's view the muscles that are involved in respiration. The external intercostals and the internal intercostals. Both of these muscles are involved in inspiration. When you breathe in, they allow for the expansion of the thoracic cavity. When you exhale, they relax. When you exhale forcefully, the internal intercostals help to compress the thoracic cavity. The prime mover of respiration is the diaphragm. It's not exactly seen on this model, but it is generally located behind or beside rib number 8. So if we come down to rib number 8, this is the general location where we would find the diaphragm. The diaphragm is innervated by the phrenic nerve. This comes from the cervical plexus. The diaphragm is innervated on both sides, so the nerve is bilateral. If something happens to one side or the other, breathing does not take place through that lung. If both of the phrenic nerves are damaged, breathing stops. Using the medium-sized muscle man, we can look at some of the muscles of the back and the lateral side of the torso and the front side of the chest. This first muscle right here is the trapezius. It gets its name from its shape because it's shaped like a trapezoid. So it's almost diamond-shaped if we were to see the other half of it here. When we talked earlier about the trapezius and its action on the head, we said that it extended the head, so holding the head upright and in proper posture. But we've got fibers also that extend out over to the shoulder. That allows for us to tilt the head and to rotate. Other fibers allow for adduction of the scapula. So squeezing them together, adducting. Another muscle that is adjacent to, but underneath the trapezius, are the rhomboids, rhomboid major and rhomboid minor. These allow for adduction of the scapula, pulling it together, as well as stabilizing the scapulae, during certain arm movements. Rotating our medium muscle man to view the lateral side, we can see the serratus muscles. Serratus muscles are attached to the ribs and to the border of the scapula, the medial border. So this allows for the scapula to be protracted or moved towards the front. This is the pectoralis minor. It's attached to several ribs on the anterior side of the body, and it's going to have an attachment at the coracoid process of the scapula. This will also act on the scapula by pulling it up and forward. Larger muscle, pectoralis major, has an attachment here at the sternum and covers over top of the ribs and the pectoralis minor. It has an attachment on the humerus. And one of its actions is to pull the arms forward, as in hugging.